Good morning. Welcome again to Chiswick Baptist Church live stream. We're so glad that you're with us today. We pray and hope that the message and the music, the worship that we're going to hear in a few moments will be a blessing to you. If you're joining us live on Facebook or through YouTube later or through our website later today, we just are so glad that you're with us, and we're praying for you, and we're hoping that this would be an encouragement to you and a help in your Christian life, or a help to you as you seek to know who God is. And maybe you're not a Christian this morning. I'm so glad that you're here today, and my prayer for you is that the Lord will open your understanding and reveal himself to you and draw you to who he is. So again, thank you for joining us today. Just a couple announcements before we get started. Again, today at 1:30, our children's Sunday school class will be on Zoom. And if you want any information pertaining to that, please email me at info@chiswick.church and we'll get the Zoom information to you. I'm really excited. Over the last 6 weeks, we've been doing Christianity Explored, and it has been a real blessing. Each week, just the conversations and just seeing God working in the heart of people has been a tremendous blessing. And I'm so thankful for Carl, who's been running that course and just being used of the Lord. And just pray for him this week as he prepares for the final lesson this Thursday night at 7:30. And we'll be closing out our first Christianity Explored course this week. But Lord willing, looking to maybe later in the summer or early autumn to be starting up another Christianity Explored course. So keep that in prayer this week. And as most of you probably already know, I think in our church this week, if you're a part of our church, you've received an email that gives a little bit of information about when we will be opening up the building. So starting on the 12th of July at 10 a.m., the church will open the building so that you can watch the live stream sermon. It won't be church as such, but you will have the opportunity, if you want, to come and to join the live stream and watch it be videotaped and streamed on the different social media sites that we use. So to help us with numbers, if you plan on attending that service on the 12th of July, use the booking form that was sent to you in the email that you got, or the one that will be on the website later in the week. And I just want you to understand that I understand the concerns that many of you have for the first phase of reopening. And I want to reassure you that we understand that everyone has to do what they feel comfortable with. And everybody has a little bit of a different of opinion of when to come back or when not to come back. And I just want to encourage you, do what the Lord leads you to do. Do what you are comfortable with. We are going to open the building, but we give that to your discretion. And we just want you to know that everything will continue on the same with the live stream. It'll just be that I do it from the pulpit, and there will be some who are watching me do that. And so as we go forward, the live stream will continue to be a part of the life and ministry of our church, even when we open for regular worship when that time comes. It has been such a blessing. It has been so useful to the glory of God that this is going to, for as long as we can see, be a permanent part of our ministry. And so you will be able to access the live stream each week at the same time through the different social media sites that you are using. And before we open the Bible this morning to look at our text, our worship team has prepared a song to minister to us. So I'm sure that it will be a blessing to you as they sing.
You are holy, worthy of praise.
Good morning. Take your Bibles and turn to the book of Hebrews chapter 12, and we'll be reading verses 1 and 2 as our text this morning. Hebrews chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. And the Bible says, "Therefore we also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down on the right hand of the throne of God." Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, this morning for your word. We thank you, Lord, for the decisions of the government in the past week or so to allow the reopening of religious organizations and restaurants and different things, and in the sense of that life is beginning to go in the direction of normalcy. But Lord, things are quite not normal yet. And Lord, I just pray this morning that we could be a blessing and an encouragement to the folks that are listening to this message today. I pray, Lord, that you'd be a strengthening and a building up of their faith as believers in Jesus Christ. And Lord, I pray that you would use this teaching, and especially verse 1 as we look at it this morning. Lord, use it to help us to grow and to become more stable on the foundation of our Christian faith and on the Word of God, and that we would do these things that the writer of Hebrews through the Holy Spirit has given to us this morning. So Lord, I pray that you enable me to just rest upon your Spirit and upon your Word, and Lord, that you would communicate the things of God to your people. And Lord, I pray that you would use this time for your glory and for your honor. And Lord, help us today. We love you. In Jesus' precious name, amen. Again, our text this morning is really verse 1, but I wanted to read the two together to give a little bit more context. Let's read it again. Therefore, we also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. What amazing verses, scripture, truth that we as Christians need this morning. Do you ever feel alone as you purpose to live for God? Do you feel as if you're the only one who lives through what you live through and that you have really no help? Do you ever think, I have so much to deal with, I can't live this life I'm supposed to as a Christian the way I should? You know, excuse me, life is a long endurance effort. I think sometimes as people, and because of the way life is now, you know, we want something, we look online, we click it, we buy it, we get it within oftentimes the next day, certainly within 2 or 3 days if all goes well. You know, we live in a society that everything is like at our fingertips. We get it, we have it, we want it, we go, and it's just there. And we think that's the way the spiritual life works. But really, the Christian life is an endurance marathon race. It's not a quick and short thing that we just grab, we got it, we win it, and it's over. It's a marathon. We make such a big deal about the start of something. You know, and rightly so, we celebrate with great effort and cost the first birthday of our firstborn child. You know, we talk about what they will become, and you know, we list out all of our expectations. And the reality is, for that child, the race is yet to be run. It's only beginning. And what really matters is not so much the beginning and the end, but what is in the middle, how we run the race, how we live the life. If you know track and field at all, and growing up as a kid, I loved the Olympics. I loved that kind of thing, and especially the Summer Olympics. And you know, you get all the runners at the start of a race, and their energies are high, and they're anticipating that gun, and the gun goes off to start, to signify the beginning of the race, and all the runners go off except one stumbles at the starting block. And you know, everybody's well ahead now, but he takes off. He or she runs with all their might, and that first time around the track, They're a little bit still behind, but they've gained a little bit. And that second time around the track, they've made it into the middle of the pack, but they keep running. They don't let the beginning hinder them what they do in the middle, and they run hard. And we've all, if you've watched track and field, you've seen those races where the gun goes off, they stumble, or somewhere in the beginning they trip and they fall, but they get up and they run. And sometimes, oftentimes, you will see them win the race. Why? Because they don't give up in the middle. The start of something is very important, But the all that is in the middle, well, that's where it really, that's what is really important. What we do in the middle, because the middle helps us determine how we make the end. What happens after you start can keep you on the course you started or guide you off the path into a different direction. You know, a young couple gets married and they're in love and they're in purpose together, desiring to live their lives together until death do them part. But at some point in the marriage, as life happens, they become distant. They become disillusioned with their life together. Things are not, for whatever reasons, what they expected or wanted. And then they give up on their dreams and vision they had on their wedding day, and they walk away from each other, or they spend the rest of their days in simply existing in this lifeless marriage. I know that sounds discouraging, but bear with me. You know, it's similar in the Christian life sometimes. A young person comes into the church, hears the gospel, places their faith in the Lord Jesus. He changes their life. There is fruit of the Spirit that is seen in their life. There's evidence that they truly are saved. You know, there's love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such there is no law. And those who are in Christ, who are Christ, have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. They go on to live their life to Christ in service and ministry. Maybe go off to seminary, get involved in a ministry, and they serve the Lord for many years. Then at some point in their life, the excitement begins to fade. And the life they began in Christ begins to fade and diminish in excitement or purpose and faithfulness in the things that they were doing. Maybe, you know, they become haphazard in going to church. Maybe they stop going to church altogether. They struggle or stop reading the Word of God. They've not stopped believing, but they stop doing the things that they should be doing. They stop doing the things that help them to be faithful and showed that they were being faithful. Deep down inside, there still remains a desire to be what Jesus wants them to be, but they've stopped running the race of the Christian life with purpose and dexterity. And the reasons this happened could be countless, boundless even. Burdens carried, battles fought and won and lost, hurts and failures from others, or hurts and failures from our own sin. Different things coming at us, letting temptation come into our life and we fall into sin. All of these things have an effect on our life. And they cause us to stop pursuing faithfulness in the Christian life the way they should. You know, as I said before, life is a marathon. And beloved, we must keep our focus on the end of the race, on the desire that we have to finish well, constantly doing what is needed to be done to get that goal, to get to that goal of, well done, you good and faithful servant of Christ. Well done, come and enter into your rest. Getting to that place in the end of our life where we can say with Paul, I've finished my course. I've run the race. I've done what he's called me to do. You know, sometimes we ask the question, why are these things happening to me? Am I the only one that carries this particular burden or this particular stress or this particular path that needs to be walked in my life as a Christian? We ask, am I less of a Christian than someone else? And insert your situation, insert your circumstances. And then we use those things to give in. We yield ourselves and we do not fight as we should. We don't live the life that Christ wants us to live as we should. We do not love as the Bible teaches that we should love as we should. We don't serve as we should, the body of Christ, the lost of our world. We don't believe and exert faith as we could. You see, there is the possibility of when you get married to limp through your married life. But nobody wants that. But we have to put in the effort not to limp through those marriages. And we need to work at them and exert ourselves in them and to love one another when each other is kind of unlovable. And we need to fight for our marriages, and we need to fight for our Christian life, because there's an enemy who is fighting against us. You know, that's the same thing in the Christian life. My example is not necessarily one of that believer who came into the church and had all these great ambitions and showed fruitfulness, and then because of life, you know, just kind of quit, meandered the rest of the way. Is not necessarily one who gave a false profession of faith, but of one who, like in our marriages sometimes, we lose our passion. We lose our excitement as a believer. We lose our focus on the race that needs to be won. And this is a danger for all of us in the Christian life. And none of us want this. Therefore, we all need to be aware of it and understand what we need to do because of this battle that we face. You see, we would all say with Paul this morning this out of Philippians. I'll paraphrase. I don't mean to say that I've already achieved these things, or that I've already reached perfection, that I've attained the pinnacle of the Christian life, but I press on to possess that perfection for which Christ Jesus first possessed me. No, dear brothers and sisters, I've not achieved it, but I focus on this one thing, forgetting the past, and I look forward to what lies ahead. I press on, I fight on to reach the end of the race and to receive the heavenly prize for which God, through Christ Jesus, is calling us. And that brings us to our text this morning. See, that's what we're to be like Paul. Pressing on, keeping the faith, fighting the good fight, running the race. In our text this morning in Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1, comes right after that great chapter 11, what is often called as the Hall of Faith. And our text gives us some help in dealing with what I've described. Dealing with, you know, succumbing to the loss of our passion and desires of living this life for Jesus Christ. You know, we're excited at the start, but the middle bogs us down at times. The middle causes us to stumble. The middle, and that's where the life is. That's where the race is won. The end, that's the victory dance, beloved. That's when we see Jesus. That's when we rejoice in glory, and that's when we take our rest. But in the middle, that's where it's fought. That's really where the battle is. And our text this morning gives us how we can continue on, as Paul said, running the race, pressing forward, forgetting the things that are behind. Our text in verse 1 tells us how we can, you know, what we need to do to fight the fight and run the race. So here is simply this morning, I want to give you some encouragement as you live your life as a believer. And it doesn't matter where we are at in our Christian faith, whether we've been saved for decades, whether we've been saved for just a few years, or whether we've only been saved for just a few months. It all pertains to each and every one of us. And so let me just give you some encouragement this morning. Encouragement to run the race. Encouragement not to give in to the things of this life and the pressures of our world. Not to give in and become bitter and hurt and discouraged and not wanting the things of the Lord and to fight in this Christian life, to press on. Number one, the number one first encouragement that I'd like to share with you is this. Man, you are not alone in this race. You're not alone. You might feel alone. You might think that you're alone. And in actuality, you might be running this race alone at the moment. But we are not alone. Even the writer of Hebrews, who I think is probably Paul, he says this in verse 1 at the very beginning. We have a cloud of witnesses. I mean, the Bible says, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses. And oftentimes, people think that this is describing that there's a group of people in heaven, saints of old that have died, and they've gone up into heaven, and they're sitting in the bleachers of glory there, and they're with their, banners and different things, and they're shouting, and they're screaming, and they're looking down from heaven, watching you and saying, go, 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 you can do it. That's not what's happening here. It's not what the Bible teaches. I know that that is what we often hear, but this great cloud of witnesses isn't a bunch of Christians in heaven cheering us on to the finish line, but it's what it really is. It is the examples of believers that have lived this Christian life faithfully and sometimes unfaithfully, where we can follow their examples and say, if they did it, we can do it too. That it can be done. This scripture where it says we're surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses means this. We have many examples before us from other Christian people, past, present, and future to come. We have these examples that show us that we can live this Christian life, that show us how to live the Christian life. I love how one of the translations puts this verse. It says this, we are surrounded by such a huge crowd of witnesses to the life of faith. See, whether you are living this on your own or not, you don't have to, because the Bible says that we are surrounded by a huge cloud of people to show us how to live the life of faith. And I just want to give it to you in two applications. This cloud of witnesses comes really in two forms. Number one, it's from the Bible examples of faith. Bible examples of believers where they have failed. Bible examples of redemption. Peter, failures, Abraham, others like that, Moses himself. And we see these stories that we can read about, and especially the examples of Hebrews 11. We can read about these examples and we can say, look, I'm like that. He did it. She did it. I can do it too. You know, we have these examples of faith, and really, all we really need to do is get into the Word of God and realize they're real life stories. They're real life people. They're just like you and I. They're not extraordinary and special. They are people who believed in God, believed His truth, believed in the Lord Jesus Christ. And sometimes they were successful and sometimes they failed. But God's Word says we have them as an example. And we can use Moses as an example of what to do and what not to do, and Abraham, and on and on and on. And we have examples of the people in the Bible, and show us God's grace, and show us God's love, and show us God's redemption, and show us God's power in redeeming a broken life and using it to the glory of God. Ruth, I believe she was a Moabitess. She was a Gentile. And yet, because she chose to believe in God by faith, God used her life, changed her life, and when everything looked hopeless, gave her a husband, gave her a child, and gave her the lineage of the Messiah. You know, that's what God can do. And beloved, we have that great cloud of witnesses to show us the glory of Christ and that we can do this. But you know, second, that cloud of witnesses includes the Christians around us. See, in our church, we have people in all different walks of their Christian life, and we need to look to one another and learn and glean and grow from each other and our faiths, in our faith. You know, we are here for one another. I think that's really how what has affected me so much in this lockdown, that we've all been reduced in our connection with one another, to encourage each other, to help each other, to uplift each other, to be the example to one another, to love one another. You know, this is the cloud of witnesses, beloved. This is what your church is here for. And this is why you're in the church, to be a part of that cloud of witnesses. You know, we have new Christians that are, when this lockdown's over and we can, they're going to come and be a part of our church, and they need you to live this life faithfully. They need to be shown the example of what to do. And maybe you're in a position this morning where you're a little bit discouraged. You know what you need? You need your cloud of witnesses. You see, the focus of the author is on the importance of current believers learning and being encouraged and strengthened by those who have lived and are living the faith before them. And here's the point. We're not alone in what we're living. We have access to those of the past and the present that have shown us the way of faith. And yeah, there are failures at times. And yes, we fail at times. But you know what? Those are not the witnesses that the Bible's talking about. It's talking about the ones who are living faithfully, the ones who have come back home and are living for the glory of God. Those are the witnesses. And beloved, if you feel alone in your faith journey today, that you have no one to walk with you, and sometimes as the church worldwide, we have failed in this, and we have not seen the need and met the need of those who are walking seemingly alone. But what I want to encourage you with this morning is this. If you feel that way, then reach out. And as a church, maybe we, the ones who are walking faithfully, we need to be more cognizant of those around us who might be struggling, and we need to reach out to them. Beloved, you are either needing a witness, the cloud of great witness, or you need to be that cloud of great witness this morning. And that is what I want to encourage you with. You're not alone, and we have a need to be that cloud for the others that are around us. I love the scripture in verse 1. Therefore, since we are surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses to this life of faith. And it immediately goes into two more points. And the next two encouragements, the next two points fall under what I call as a heading, personal evaluation. You know, we don't evaluate our own spiritual condition enough. We don't examine our life enough to determine what needs changed, what needs to be repented of, what needs to be put away, what needs to be increased in our life. We need to do personal evaluation constantly as a Christian. Let me give you a little illustration. I'll come home from work or visiting or doing whatever, and I'll trip over something as I come through the front door. There's a box of stuff, lots of boxes sometimes, and bags of things from the house laying at the front door, needing to either go into the garage or into the car, down to the charity shop or something like that. You know why? Because Lisa has been evaluating how the home has been running. She's been evaluating what we have. She's been evaluating what we're doing. She's been evaluating the effectiveness of the home life. And she's made some decisions. From that evaluation, she's changed something or built something and constantly examines our home. And then she finds something that needs her attention and she deals with it. Why? She's constantly revamping, evaluating how she runs the house, the school, the chores, the meals, everything. Do you know why? Because she wants it to be more effective. She wants it to be better. She wants it to be good. She wants it to be helpful and honoring and good for the kids and for me and for herself. And as a testimony to the world that we live in, that's why she does it. You know, I came home this week And I walked into the house and, you know, she says, come and see what I've done. And I'm thinking, okay, what has she changed now? And what has she done? She opens up my closet and she said, evaluate. And for about in 5 minutes, she reduced my closet by over probably 50% of the things that were in it. And it has become a lot easier and better organized to get clothes and do different things. She evaluates, she revamps, and she does it because she wants things to be better. Now, in the Christian life, we need to be doing the same thing. You know, the Bible calls us to examine, to evaluate. 2 Corinthians, examine yourselves whether you are in the faith. Test yourselves. Do you not know yourselves that Jesus Christ is in you, unless indeed you are disqualified? 1 Corinthians, but let a man examine himself, and then so go and do. James says, but be doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving yourselves. For if anyone is a hearer of the word, not a doer, he is like a man that observes his natural face in a mirror, but goes away, does nothing about it, and forgets what kind of man he was. Romans says, do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve. Examine what God's will is, that is good, pleasing, and perfect. You see, why are we to spiritually evaluate our lives? Because the Bible says, therefore, since we are surrounded by all these people that shows us the way of life, of the Christian life, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us. The reason we are to evaluate is so we can get rid of things or not allow things to affect us that will keep us from living this life of faith the way that we should. To lay aside means to stop a condition. It's to stop oneself from being in a certain state. So Paul says, lay the weights down. Paul says, lay those sins that easily beset you, the thing that is easily through temptation that grabs a hold of you. Stop those things, lay those things aside. And that's why evaluation is so important in our Christian life. See, I'll read you a quote. The writer of Hebrews does not give us a list of what weight to lay aside or what sin that is so easily ensnaring us. I'm sorry, that's not the quote. But the statement is, the writer of Hebrews does not give us a list of what weight or what sin there is. Do you know why? Because it's personal. It's different for all of us. What weighs me down, what sin easily besets me is different than the ones that do that to Lisa or to my children. The weight or the sin that easily gets you that you need to lay aside is different for you than it is for me. And that is why we need to evaluate our life, because we need to lay those things down. We need to stop those things. Here's the quote that I wanted to read to you. The weight is something that weighs us down. It diverts our attention. It takes our energy. It dampens our enthusiasm for the things of God. We cannot win. We cannot run when we are carrying excess weight. When we ask about a certain habit or a condition, well, what's wrong with that? And the answer often is, well, nothing in itself. But the problem is not in what the weight is, but the problem is in what the weight does. And maybe even innocent things at times can weigh us down as Christians, that it prohibits us from running this Christian life well. See, I know what weight is pretty well from being in the Army. When our drill sergeants in training wanted to really, you know, just beat us down, they would come around and put rocks, stones, bricks in our rucksacks as we go on these road marches. Why? Because that extra weight is going to weigh us down, wear us out, and they were trying to break us. And what the Word of God says is we need to evaluate our Christian life. Watch other believers as they live it. and lay aside those weights. Stop those things that can easily ensnare us and cause us to fall into sin. See, I'm not going to give you a list this morning of weight or easily besetting sins. I want you to look within. I want you to pray about it. I want you to seek God's face. I want you to ask Him, Lord, what in my life right now could be weighing me down from running this race? What am I tampering with? What am I playing with? What match is being striked that might start into a flame of sin that I'm involved in? Lord, please show me. Guide me, Lord. Lead me. Keep me from those things, Lord. Help me to put off those things so that I may do what you want me to do and to be faithful. We are to lay it aside. And here's my question. Why? Why is it, Christian, so important for you and I to lay these weights aside, to lay these sins aside? Why is it so important for us to understand we're not alone in this life, and we have Christians that we can look to, both past and present, now, so that we can have examples of what it is to live this life of faith? Why is that so important? Because what Paul writes next is this: let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. Oh, Christian, listen, listen. God has a life for you to live, a life of faithfulness, a life of purpose, a life of giving glory to Him. And what He has told Paul to write through the Holy Spirit is this: it's because we need to run the race. Let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. We need to be spiritually moving forward. You know what that's talking about? It's talking about this: growing in faith. Growing as a believer in Christ. Becoming more like Jesus, having a testimony of salt and light in this world, touching and affecting people for Jesus Christ. And you know how we do that? We look to our examples. We lay aside the weight. We stop giving into that temptation by the grace of God, and we lay that sin aside so that we can run, that we can grow in this life of faith and serve our risen Savior, Jesus Christ. So I'll close with this. Here's the application. Believer, you are in the race. Your goal, your mission is to grow into the believer that you are to become. To constantly, until you see Jesus, be growing in your faith, growing as a Christian and becoming more like Jesus. That's the course. That's the race. And that's the thing that we are to run, growing in our faith. And you know what? Doesn't matter what you're going through. Doesn't matter what burden you are facing. Doesn't matter what your circumstances are. Because there are those who've been there, have done it, and they've been faithful. You read it in the Bible. You see it in the brothers and sisters in church. You can hear the stories and through biographies and on and on and on. Because God doesn't call us to be a Christian to fail. God calls us and saves us and equips us to be able to live the Christian life pleasing to Him. Not in our power, but in the power of Christ. And even Paul said, I was such a wicked and awful sinner. Paul was on and on and saying how he didn't deserve to be a Christian in different things. And if I can find the verse, I will share it with you. It just came to my mind, but I'd love to say this to you. He says, and I thank Christ Jesus our Lord, who has enabled me. Paul puts it all on Christ. His faithfulness, the work that he would be able to do, everything that he did, even his faithfulness, the ministry that he was in, even though he was a former blasphemer and a persecutor and an insolent man, but he obtained mercy. And you know what he says? It is Christ who enables me. And beloved Christian, that's who enables us as well. So know that you're not alone. And if you are, it's not supposed to be that way. And let us reach for each other. You reach to us, we reach to you, and we live for the glory of God. You have a cloud of witness to this life of faith. And believer, don't ever stop evaluating where you're at. Don't ever stop evaluating and examining your spiritual life. Lay aside the things he shows you. Stop doing the things he tells you to stop. Flee temptation. And you know what? Run. Run. Grow. Grow in grace. And for the glory of God, do it. Do it for him. Amen? That's my encouragement to you this morning. I love you. I'm praying for you. Just look to him. We didn't get to it today, but the rest of that verse in our text says this: looking unto Jesus. That's where it's at. God bless you, beloved. Amen.